Welcome to Whiteboard Programming, where we simplify programming with easy to understand whiteboard videos. And today I'll be sharing with you what are microservices, components it offers, types of microservices, alongside why they are employed in business. So let's get started. First off, let's start with understanding what are microservices. To state its meaning, microservices are smaller, loosely coupled services that you can deploy independently. Here, the term services refer to different functions of an application. So you can say that in a microservice architecture, an application's functions are divided into many smaller components serving specific purposes. These components or services are fine-grained and usually have separate technology stacks, data management methods, and databases. And they can communicate with other services of the application via REST APIs, message brokers, and streaming. The microservices architecture is an effective approach to building applications. Since the services are loosely coupled and distributed, even if something happens in one of the services, it won't affect the rest of the system, unlike traditional approaches. Here, loose coupling helps in reducing the complexities and dependencies of an application. Thus, development teams can accelerate the process of developing new app components and meet increasing business needs. Also, do note that the term microservices and microservice are completely different from one another and signify distinct meanings in the industry context. Why, you ask? As a microservice represents an application's core functionality and runs independently. Whereas, on the other hand, the term microservices signify the complete architecture for building an application. It goes beyond core functions and loose coupling. Further, microservices also define your development processes and communications to enable integration of new features, provide scalability, and prepare you for failures and issues. Next, to get a better clarity, let's look into a few examples of microservices. So, the top organizations like Amazon, Netflix, PayPal, Meta, Twitter, etc. all have evolved from traditional monolithic architecture to microservices. It's no doubt that this architecture has helped them achieve greater success by offering seamless scaling, business agility, and higher profits. And to understand the concept better here, I'll be taking up the example of Amazon in this video. As we all know it, Amazon was not as big as today in the early 2000s. The retail site was a monolithic application back in the day, and that's why if its developers needed to create or scale or upgrade Amazon's system, it was tough and required them to manage dependencies very carefully each time for a monolithic application with multiple components and tiers tied very tightly together. Thus, it restricted flexibility and increased complexity as the application grew with its larger code base. This created an overhead for development teams and slowed down their development processes as a whole, which furthermore created trouble in meeting the scaling demands of the application and matching customer expectations. So, as a solution, they adopted to a microservices architecture, for which at first they analyzed all their source code carefully and extracted code units serving them a single functionality. Next, they wrapped those code units into a web-based service interface for ease of use. For example, they built a separate payment service altogether, a single component for their buy option. And furthermore, to make things more scalable, Amazon also assigned a services ownership to developers to view issues closely and resolve them as soon as they see them coming. Wonderful, right? Yes, it truly is. But there are types of microservices and each have their own application as well. Broadly, microservices can be categorized into stateless and stateful microservices. Here, stateless microservices are the building blocks of the distributed system. They don't maintain or store any session state between two requests, hence the name stateless arrives here. In addition, even if a service instance is removed, the service's overall processing logic is not at all affected. This is why distributed systems leverage stateless microservices seamlessly. On the contrary, stateful microservices maintain or store session states or data in the code. And when these type of microservices communicate, they always maintain these service requests. Between the two of them, stateless microservices are used more widely in the industry. Next, let's learn about the different components of microservices, starting with number one, clients. Now, these can be applications, websites, or other services. Microservices architecture include various types of clients to handle some tasks, such as performing a search, configuring, building, etc. Number two, API gateway. This is the point of entry for client so that they can forward request to a particular service. The reason for using an API gateway is that the clients do not directly call the services. By using API gateways, it offers many benefits to us, like keeping the service updated, providing load balancing, security, and a lot more. Number three, identity providers. Client requests are forwarded to the identity providers to authenticate those requests and communicate them to the internal services via an API gateway. Number four, data handling. Now, microservices have private databases to store their information and implement business functionality. Number five, messaging. Microservices interact with each other via messages to manage client requests. These messages can be of two types: synchronous, where the server waits to get a real-time response, or asynchronous, where the client doesn't wait for any response before acting. Number six, static content. Microservices, after communicating with each other, deploy other static content to a cloud storage service to enable direct delivery of the content to the clients using a content delivery network, or CDN. Next, number seven, service delivery. This is a microservice guide to finding communication routes between the microservices. It manages a service list where nodes are found. Now that we have a clear idea about what is a microservice and its components, let's discuss about a popular doubt. Are microservices RESTful? Well, to be honest, not necessarily. Why you ask? Because as told by me earlier, microservices is a collection of functions and services acting as building blocks of an application. On the contrary, RESTful APIs represents protocols, commands, and rules for integrating all microservices into one single application. Now here, microservices is all about an application's design style and architecture. And you can build microservices with or without using a RESTful API. That being said, using a RESTful API will surely make it a lot easier to develop loosely coupled microservices. That is a true fact as well. Lastly, a few of the advantages or benefits of using microservices include better scaling, higher security, independent deployment, seamless integration, simple routing, easier maintenance and debugging, and modularity, by which we mean that it divides services into different modules with their own set of functionalities and dependencies to make an application easy to develop, test, and understand. And although microservices seem like an efficient approach that can offer you plenty of benefits, which it truly does offer, there are some challenges too that microservices offer. Like with the microservices, logging data can be a burden. And moving from traditional monolithic architecture to microservices can be complex with plenty of services, teams, and deployments. And also, do not forget that more networks will invite more connectivity and latency issues in the system. And last but not least, new software versions can pose backward compatibility problems as well. But all in all, if we calculate risks involved, the benefits still weigh a lot more than the risks themselves. With that, I hope this video was helpful to you and served value. If you love my content, feel free to smash that like button. And if you haven't already subscribed to my channel, please do, as it keeps me motivated and helps me create more content like this for you.